Well, good morning, everybody. Good morning. Oh, very good. We are so excited that each and every one of you are here, particularly if you braved that nasty rain that just happened a few seconds ago. It really came down really strong there, which is great because I just put some seed out on my grass, so that was going to be excellent. Well, hey, in your bulletin, you have it says, come sit with me. And on this is simply just an invitation for you to think about and pray about who you might invite to church this next week. You know, studies will say that 8 out of 10 people will come with you and they'll attend church with you if you just simply ask. If you risk that awkwardness and make that invitation, 8 out of 10 people will come. So I'm encouraging you to pray about somebody who you might want to invite to the services. And also in your card or in the seat back in front of you, there is a guest connection card. If you're with us, this is your first time, we'd love for you to fill that out and so we can start a relationship with you and start a conversation with you. We have some exciting things going on in the life of our church. Particularly, this is a new season for our music ministry, so we get to hear some new songs, and we're very excited about that. Thank you so much for coming, and look forward to seeing more of you after the service.
It is good to be in the house of the Lord. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Pray with me. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we gather here today and in churches all over the world to praise you, to worship you, and to give thanks to you. We thank you for all creation. We thank you for Jesus and our salvation. We thank you for the guidance and power of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Help us to hear our Pastor Tony as he brings your message to us. Help us to be quick to do your will. Be with us, our families, our church, our community. Give wisdom to the leaders of all nations on earth. We pray your protection on the service people who protect us. Be with our medical personnel as they minister to our health needs. Comfort those who are grieving. Be with us as we worship and adore you through our words, our songs, and our acts of love to one another. Be with us as we leave to be aware of your calling to us. Grant us wisdom. Grant us peace. In the holy name of Jesus, we pray.
Amen. Thank you, Jean. I have a question for you. Does Jesus make a difference in your life? Would you sing that with me? 441. What a wonderful change in my life has been wrought since Jesus came into my heart. We'll stand as we sing. 441.
Oh,
seated.
This is Psalm 103, verses 1 through 12. Let all that I am praise the Lord with my whole heart. I will praise his holy name. Let all that I am praise the Lord. May I never forget the good things he does for me. He forgives all my sins and heals all my diseases. He redeems me from death and crowns me with love and tender mercies. He fills my life with good things. My youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord gives righteousness and justice to all who are treated unfairly. He revealed his character to Moses and his deeds to the people of Israel. The Lord is compassionate and merciful, slow to get angry and filled with unfailing love. He will not constantly accuse us nor remain angry forever. He does not punish us for all our sins. He does not deal harshly with us as we deserve. For his unfailing love toward those who fear for him is as great as the height as the heavens above the earth. He has removed our sins as far from us as the east is from the west.
Now that is good news.
Amen.
You may remain seated as we sing together, I Will Never Be the Same Again. The words are printed inside your bulletin. If you don't know it, you can listen once and then sing along. I will never be the same again. I can never return. I've closed the door. I will walk the path.
You know, a church is, yes, it's an institution. Yes, you have governance. But at the heart of it, a church is a family. And we here together are a family. And God just kind of impressed upon me this week that there are a number in our family that are have been going through some health issues. Either they've had surgery or they are about to have surgery. And so to get today, I'd just like to just spend a moment as a family just praying for those who, for our family members who have been going through surgery. We pray that they would find quick healing. And we pray for those upcoming who will have surgery, that we pray that God would guide the thoughts and the hands of the doctors and the nurses and the various medical staff. So would you please pray with me as we lift up our various church body family members. Father, we thank you for First Baptist Church of Winchester. We thank you for everybody who has participated. God, we thank you for the leaders who have given so sacrificially. Father, we ask right now, we ask that you would be with those who have had some medical issues. God, we ask that you would flood their heart with peace. We ask for healing, knowing full well that you are the healer, and we call upon you for that. Father, we ask that those who will have surgery, God, we ask that you would calm their hearts. God, give them a peace that is beyond understanding. Father, we ask that you would guide the thoughts and the hands of the surgeons and the doctors and the nurses and the various people who will be administering to them. God, we know that you are able. You're the God who can take darkness and you turn it into light. You're the God who can take our scars and you turn them into something beautiful. We know that you are able. And it is upon that that we give that to you. In your precious and mighty and holy name we pray. Amen.
So if you were here last week, you know we have started a new sermon series on the book of Galatians. And our pastor has challenged us to be bringing our Bible to worship on Sundays. And I hope that not only on Sundays, but every day of the week, you find yourself hungry for God's word, because God's word is life. That's what our offertory hymn says today, 261, Wonderful Words of Life. Let's stand as we sing together.
Dear Heavenly Father, we're so glad to be in your house today. What a wonderful place to be. We pray that you'll be with these tithes and these offerings and help further your kingdom here on earth. Be with us and guide us in what we say and do, and teach us to love others. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
That was okay. That was really excellent. My goodness, thank you. That really blessed me. That was a blessing. Thank you, Maria. Thank you, choir. Well, if you have your Bibles, go ahead and pull those out. If you don't have a Bible, go ahead and take out the one in front of you in the seat back, and we could go along with that. So we're going to be in Galatians this morning, and we're going to be continuing our series, and we're going to be in Galatians chapter 1. And last week, we kind of discussed this idea that, you know, when you focus only on rituals and customs and kind of rules, you're left with this empty shell called religion. Now, rules and rituals are not bad in themselves, because in chapter 3, he's actually going to say, listen, you need to find some of these things that will actually birth life into you. So he's not doing away with them. But what he's saying is that Jesus has always been enough. He's always more than enough. And he will always be more than enough. So today, we're going to be focusing on the rest of chapter 1. So with your Bible in hand, let's go ahead and look at the very first text that we have. It's verse 11 and 12. Let's read that together. But you don't have to read that out loud, okay? Just so we're clear on that one. All right, so, for I would have you know, brethren, that the gospel which was preached by me is not according to man. For I neither received it from man, nor was I taught it, but I received it through a revelation of Jesus Christ. Now remember, back in verse 1, he introduces this idea of apostleship, and he's kind of he's kind of going out and saying, listen, I am an apostle, and he's trying to claim his authority as an apostle in this new movement that's created by Jesus. And a good bulk of the first and second chapters is Paul asserting that, hey, he is every bit of an apostle as everyone else. But the thing about it is, nobody trained him in the gospel. He wasn't trained by like a seminary. He wasn't trained by other people. He wasn't trained by like some school. He was trained actually by Christ himself. And so you see, there was this kind of tension. Because with the other apostles, they walked and talked with Jesus. So they knew him. So when they were writing about Jesus, it's because like when they would say, Jesus did this, it's because they saw him do it. Or when they say, oh, Jesus, I heard Jesus say this, it's because they heard Jesus say this. And so the other apostles kind of had this front row seat into Christ's ministry. In fact, what does the opening verse of Luke say? Like, what is the opening tagline of Luke say? You don't have to go there, but you can just mark it. The opening verse says, this is an eyewitness account of all the things that we have seen and heard about Jesus with our own eyes and our own ears. The apostles had this firsthand knowledge of Jesus. And as a result, there was kind of this deeply held belief amongst people and other that the apostles had kind of a more of an in than anybody else, especially Paul. So that makes sense, right? So I've only watched Kentucky basketball on a TV. All right, I've only watched like 5 games on it. I know that's blasphemous for me to say I've only watched 5 games, but I've only watched 5 games of Kentucky basketball on TV. Now, I don't know all that much about Kentucky basketball, that being said, but some of you have graduated from Kentucky, right? She's quick to raise her hand. Some of you have graduated from Kentucky. Some of you, and if you were to graduate from Kentucky or you've been to these basketball games, right, it's a whole nother experience because you have this knowledge base of somebody who hasn't been there, right? Like, you know where to park, you know where to go, you know where to eat. You kind of have all this knowledge base that somebody who just didn't go there has, right? And so, but what Paul, so you would naturally assume that they have more of kind of inside information than you do. But what Paul is saying here is, no. That's not the case, y'all. That is not the case. I didn't receive the gospel from any one person or school. I received it from God. And because of that, I come with the same authority and the same power as any one of them. But let's make just a little side note here, okay? This is where, if you have your pen and you're making notes, this is a descriptive verse, not a prescriptive verse. So what's that saying? Paul's just kind of explaining how he came to understand the gospel. He's not so much saying this is how you'll come to hear it. Like, nobody's going to come and say, like, you're not going to hear an audible voice from God saying this is the intricacies of the gospel, okay? So, like, And if you do, maybe just don't tell anybody about that, okay? Just kind of keep that one to yourself, all right? Like, it's going to be more of a, this is more descriptive than prescriptive. So but what we're going to notice is I really want to focus in on the next couple of verses here because they are so important. And what we notice is that he writes something so fundamental that we need to grasp. So let's look at verses 13 and 14. And that's where we're going to spend the majority of our time this morning. It says, "For you have heard of my former manner of life in Judaism, how I used to persecute the church of God beyond measure and tried to destroy it. And I was advancing in Judaism beyond many of my contemporaries among my countrymen, being more extremely zealous for my ancestral traditions." And so what we will find in this text this morning is that God has much to say about how the gospel can change your life. So the question that you and I are going to ask this morning is this: how exactly does the gospel change our life? How does it actually, in what practical ways does the gospel change my life? How does it change the way I relate to my children? How does it change the way I relate to my wife or my husband? How does it change the way I relate to my boss? How does it change, like, my deepest relationships in life? How will your life be different in and through the power of the gospel? And so as we look to answer that question, we're going to go through 2 points this morning, and that's going to help us understand this question. And what we will see outlined in this morning text is this: a picture of a life of somebody who has misplaced priorities. So the first thing we're going to do is the picture of a life of someone who has misplaced priorities. And the second is the cost associated with having a life with misplaced priorities. So a picture of a life with misplaced priorities and the cost associated with having misplaced priorities. And by looking at these 2 points, we're then going to be able to answer the question, how exactly does the gospel change my life? So first, let's consider that first point. What is the picture of a life with somebody who has misplaced priorities? Now, I want you to notice in that those verses, in verses 13 and 14, Paul, what word does he use to describe his devotion to his Jewish traditions? He uses the word zealous. In fact, he says, "I was especially zealous." If you have underlined that, it's so critical to know that, because that is very important to our understanding of what it means to have misplaced priorities. So on one level, Paul is saying, listen, I get it. I was a Pharisee. I was part of this kind of this movement. I was part of it. Listen, I'm telling you, when they're focusing on rules and rituals, they're just kind of missing the mark, and they're missing out on the richness of life. But on another level, what he's saying is that, listen, there are some real dangers that can happen when we live out of misplaced priorities. There is real danger in this world when you and I do not have our priorities correct, and we maybe value creation over the Creator. And so how do you know? Here's the question that we have to ask before we can move on. How do you know if your priorities are out of whack? Or let me back up. How do you know what your priorities are? That's a question right now. How do you know what your priorities are? And I would say it's this: is that there's a trail in each and every one of our lives. And at the end of that trail is the thing that we prioritize most in our life. So let's diagnose what our priorities are. First priority: what is it that you talk about most in your household? Like, what, you don't have to, don't answer that next door. Oh, okay, don't. They're laughing because I think somebody already answered it. But you don't have to answer it out there, okay? Number one thing: what is it that you talk about most? Like, what is the one thing that you talk about all the, like, if you have a wife or you have a spouse, what is it that they're sick of you talking about, okay? Like, is it just me and my household that I do that? Okay, no. All right, what's the one thing that you talk about all the time? That's the first marker. Second marker: where does your money go, right? This isn't a call to say start tithing. This is a call to say, when you look at your money, where exactly does it go? Like, what will you adjust everything for in order for you to do that, have that, keep that, right? So you have these, so where does your money go? The third thing you want to talk about is, where does your time go? Like, where's all your time? Like, because we'll make priorities for, like, the things we want to do. Like, this week, I'll be honest with you, I didn't work out at all. like, not at, I should have, because I ate too many pizzas this week, but like, I mean, I didn't work out at all. What am I saying? This week it was not a priority. So where's your time going? And the fourth one would be is like, where's your energy going? So when you follow the trail of all of that, whatever is there, like whatever's the leading category in most of those things, what it is going to be is your priority. That's going to be the thing that you prioritize most in this life. And what Paul is describing here is how dangerous it can be when we live out of misplaced priorities. In fact, turn with me to Acts chapter 7, if you would. We're going to go left a little bit, okay? Just not too much. We're going to go Acts chapter 7. And so let me give you some backstory to Acts here. Acts chapter 7 is what we do. We find a guy, and we find this is a story about a guy named Stephen and Saul. Now, Stephen, he's basically telling this group of Jewish believers, the Sanhedrin, they're kind of like the religious system. What he's saying here is, listen, you guys have missed the mark. You have missed it. You are missing out. I understand you really are trying to communicate the heart of God, but you have missed it, and you're missing out on the richness of life. And then there's this other guy, and his name is Saul. And it's actually Paul, but it's before his conversion. We don't have time to go into that. But it's actually, his name is Saul. And at this point, what you need to know about Saul is this, is that when anybody thought of Saul, they really thought that, like, what you would kind of think of Saul is that he would say that Christianity is an infectious disease and it needs to be wiped out. Okay, so that's kind of the backstory to Acts chapter 7, verse 54. So let's go ahead and start there. It says, now, when they heard this, they were cut to the quick, and they began gnashing their teeth at him. But being full of the Holy Spirit, he gazed intently into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. And he said, behold, I see the heavens opened up and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. But they cried out with a loud voice, and they covered their ears, and they rushed at him with one impulse. Verse 58. When they had driven him out of the city, they began stoning him. Now, it wasn't with Nerf balls, okay? This was like with real stones. They started stoning him, and the witnesses laid aside their robes at the feet of a young man named Saul. And they went on stoning Stephen as he called to the Lord. And he said, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Then falling on his knees, he cried out with a loud voice, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. Having said this, he fell asleep. Verse 1. Saul was heartily in agreement with putting him to death. And on that day, a great persecution began against the church in Jerusalem. And they were all scattered throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. Some devout men buried Stephen and made lamentation over him. But Saul began ravaging the church, entering household after household, and dragging off men and women, and he put them in prison. Now, one of the questions we have to ask about that story is, why did people lay coats? Like, why did people lay their jackets at the feet of Saul? Like, what is happening? I would say, if you're reading that story, that's a very peculiar thing to add. Like, why would somebody put jackets at the feet of Saul? I get all the rest of it, but that's a very, very interesting point that the writer put there. And what this story is showing is that, without giving you too much backstory, what this is saying is what he's doing here is essentially he's taking responsibility for the death of Stephen. Under Roman law, the Sanhedrin, which he was a part of, was not able to put anybody to death. They weren't able to execute anybody. And so the only ones who could execute somebody was the Roman government. So what was going on then was he was saying, listen, if anybody gets wind of like somebody killing Stephen, what he was saying was, listen, I'll take the blame. Listen, I'm the one who will take the blame. He felt so passionate about wiping out Christianity that he was willing to pay the cost for the very thing that he felt passionate about, even if it meant hurting himself or with others. So, in other words, what is that saying? His passion, his zeal, his priorities in life were causing pain to other people. When your life is unbalanced, your priorities are eventually going to hurt you or somebody else. See, you can be passionate about some really good things. You can be passionate about some really good things, but still miss out on what God would have for you. You miss out on a life, the richness of life of when God is your first priority. Let me give you an example of that. When I was in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, I met this guy. He was a character. Anybody met a character in life? Yeah, maybe I'm your character. I don't know. So, met this guy, and he was a little heavyset. Now, the story's not about me, okay? So, just so we're all clear. He was a little heavyset. His wife was a little heavyset. His kids were a little heavyset. And he decided one day, you know what? I need to start eating right. Now, would you all agree that eating right is a good thing? Like, having a healthy diet is a good thing? Would we all agree with that? Yeah, we'd all agree with that. Maybe not on Sunday mornings, because that's the time when we need to eat, you know, sausage and cream cheese, biscuits, wherever that. Somebody made it downstairs, and it was delicious. I had, like, way too many helpings of that this morning. So, but this guy, friend of a friend, he decided that, you know what, I need to start working out a little bit. I need to start making my diet just better. And so what did he do? He started eating right. And his family didn't really follow suit, but he started doing it anyways. And so he started getting a little trim. He started, you know, all that water retention started kind of leaving, and he was feeling good, looking good. And he said, oh, you know what? Now I need to start doing some weights. I got to start lifting some iron, throwing some weights around. And so all of a sudden he starts lifting weights, and I mean, he really transforms his body. I mean, really transforms his body. Then he says, oh, man, okay, things are going well. I'm really liking this. So then he starts spray tanning. You know, he starts doing the suntan. I don't know why. Listen, I don't know why he did that. But he did it and looking like a reject of Jersey Shore, I guess. I don't know. But, I mean, he just was not looking great. And then all of a sudden, he starts taking supplements. And then all of a sudden, I get wind that him and his wife are having problems. And then all of a sudden, I get wind that he has left his wife. And then all of a sudden, I get wind that he has divorced his wife. And then all of a sudden, I get wind that he's about my age. He married a little 22-something gym person as well. Then I get wind that he opens up a gym. And then I get wind that he never really goes around his family anymore. And what started as a really good priority turned out to hurt a lot of people, because you can have some really good priorities, but if it is not God, it will eventually hurt you or somebody else. And so, my question to you, have you ever experienced pain because somebody had misplaced priorities? You don't have to answer that out loud. Just ask yourself that question. Have you ever experienced pain because somebody had misplaced priorities? Follow-up question to that, and maybe a little bit more diagnostic. Have you ever hurt somebody because you had misplaced priorities? Fortunately, the answer is yes for both of those questions to me. But going back to Galatians, what Paul is saying here is that when Jesus isn't your first priority, it doesn't make life better. In fact, it just hurts people. Listen to me. Anytime you make work, school, power, church, money, fame, sex, lust, fill in the blank. Anytime you make that your priority instead of God, what you are doing is saying yes to self and no to God, and over time, you will begin to hurt yourself and hurt other people. And I want you to just write this down. Nobody drifts towards godliness. Not one of us in this room drifts towards godliness. We have to work at it to make our priorities God and make sure that he's the first priority. And that takes work and it takes discipline over time. None of us in this room, I don't care if you have been here for 50 years or you're just starting out, none of us drift towards godliness. We have to work at it. And so, this is the picture of a life of somebody who has misplaced priorities. They're going to hurt people, and they're going to hurt themselves along the way. Now, let's look at the cost. We've kind of talked about the cost, but I want to talk about a specific cost. Is that okay, John? Yeah, okay. Well, all right. We're going to talk about a specific cost of, 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 of somebody who has misplaced priorities. Now, to do that, I have to talk about what happened to me this week. On Tuesday, Clay Wills came up to the office. And, oh, you know, whenever I get with Clay, that's just trouble. He is, I love Clay. He's just a kindred spirit. I love hanging out with him. And I knew this story was going to go wild when he came up to the office and said, "Hey, Pastor, you want to go cow baiting?" And I was like, "Excuse me, what are we doing here? Like, what is this?" And he's like, "We're going cow baiting." I said, "Oh, well, it's Clay, so I'm going to say yes. We need to go cow baiting." And so we jump in the truck, and I have no idea what cow baiting is, by the way. Like, not a clue. I'm a city guy. I don't have a clue what cow baiting is. I kind of have an idea, but I don't have an idea. So we jump in the truck, and he shows me all about Winchester, and he says, this is the Wise's farm, and this is so-and-so's house, and he just shows me all over Winchester, and we get to his property, and his property's about 150 acres, or this particular property. And so we get through a couple gates, and we see, it must be like, I don't know, 100 acres. I say that, I have no idea how big these acres are. As the crow flies, I don't know. It's like maybe 75 acres. And so there are just cattle everywhere. I mean, just everywhere. And they're not anywhere near us. So he kind of drives, and he's driving, and he just kind of pulls in the middle of the field, and there's no cattle around us, so I'm feeling pretty safe. And so he looks over at me and says, "Hey, Tony, you know I speak fluent cow, don't you?" And I'm like, "What?" And I said, "Okay." And he said, no, "I speak fluent cow." And so I said, "All right, whatever." And so he just out of nowhere, he just goes, "Mah!" And I'm like, "What in the world is going on?" And so, I mean, he's like, "No." And then all of a sudden, these 100 cattle just start going, "Mah, mah," or whatever cattle do. I don't know if that's exactly how it is. My heart was racing at the time. But what then transpired is this. He said, "Well, cow baiting is this, is you take a little bit of corn and you just throw it out there in the field and they start running at you." And he started throwing that. I mean, he went but here to this podium and he throws it out there, and I kid you not, 100 cattle come running towards us. I mean, and they come eating like this corn, like it, and these, I forget how big cattle are. Like, some of them are 700 pounds. Like, and so they're just running, and I feel the ground beneath me trembling, right? Like, I mean, it's trembling, and they're all right here. And so Clay's just like, "Mah," and he's just throwing this corn everywhere. And so, like, here's the truck right here, and I'm kind of nervous. And he looks over at me, and he's like, "You know, they're more scared of you than you are of it." And I'm like, "That's not true, Clay." And so he starts, I get on the other side of the truck, right? And so what does he do? He starts following me with the corn, throwing the corn. And they're like going to the same path I'm going to. And I am like, I'm ready to hightail, you know? And luckily he ran out of corn. And so we jumped in his truck and he showed me the rest of his property. And he showed me all around his 150 acres there and showed me his neighbors and all this great stuff. And then as we were leaving, one of the gates, like right by one of the gates, there was this old plow. I mean, just this old, old plow. And he says, "That was my grandfather's plow." And he said, "That has not been used for decades." He said, "That has not been used for decades. There was weeds growing up over it. It was rusted. You could tell it had just been sitting there for a long time." And I thought to myself, that is the cost associated with having misplaced priorities. We are left in a position where God will not use us and we will not be usable to the master. And we will find ourselves just sitting on the side as God's working his kingdom. We'll consider 2 Timothy 2:20. "In a large house there are many articles, not of gold and silver, but also of wood and clay. Some are for special purposes, and some are for common use. The latter will be instruments for special purposes, made holy, useful to the master, and prepared for many good works." What's that mean? It means that by living with the right priorities, you will find yourself in a situation where God will use you in ways that you could never imagine. However, for those who live with misplaced priorities, you will find yourself much like that plow as God's kingdom is going about and you will be on the side. So, we've looked at the picture of somebody who has misplaced priorities. Their zeal, their passion is for maybe some good things, maybe bad things, but they're going to hurt people along the way. We've looked at a cost of what does it actually cost you to live a life of misplaced priorities. So now we're prepared to answer that original question. How does the gospel actually change our life? How is it that it actually changed our lives? And here's what I would say the answer is. The answer is that it drives us to make God the source of all our actions. The gospel gives us the power to drive us to make God the source of all our actions. For every single one of us this morning, we have the ability, through Christ, to align our priorities with His. Would you please stand to your feet? And the question that I want each and every one of you to ask in the quietness of your mind, if you're able, please stand. The question as we close our time this morning, the question I want you to ask is this, in the quietness of your mind, here it is. Which God do the actions of your life point to? Because they don't always point to the one who hung on the cross. Which actions do your life point to? Because they don't always point to the one who hung on the cross. You know, I've only been a pastor for about 12 years now, and I know some of you have shoes older than that. I get it. I do. But in my 12 years, one of the most heartbreaking things I've ever seen is somebody who claims the cross of Christ, but they let other priorities dictate their actions. And our scripture this morning is a call for us to consciously be aware that we must connect all of our choices back to the person of Jesus. The stories we tell with our lives must be linked to the power of the gospel. And the hope that each one of us have this morning is that we can always adjust our priorities. Eternal beings were not meant to live for temporary priorities. And we can always adjust our priorities.
Would you turn to 139? If you have a decision to make, we welcome you to come forward. 139.
Sinners, so
We have a birthday here. We've got Jack and Joanne Wise, and she is going to be turning 86, and they've been married 65 years. Y'all give them a hand. That is awesome. That is excellent. And she said for their anniversary, they're going to go cow baiting. No. Hey, guys, y'all come down after the service, and y'all hug on their neck and congratulate them. And she's making a fresh declaration to Christ for her birthday this year. And so we've got exciting things going on in the life of the church. This Wednesday, my bride and I are going to be kind of giving our story and telling how God has worked in our lives, and we're going to be kind of sharing how we even got here and how we got in the ministry, and just so you guys can get a chance to know us and learn a little bit more about us. We're going to be here Wednesday night downstairs. We've got kids activities, we've got food, we got it all. So we've got some great things going on in the life of the church, and so I'm excited. So may God bless you, and may His make His face shine upon you. Go in peace.
Peace, everybody.